Okay, so what I'm trying to what I want to show you today is acceptance versus free charges, and trying to give you a photophysical picture of organolead trialide perovskite materials. So in the field of in the family of the third generation solar cells, excitonic solar cells probably have attracted lots of attention in the last 20 years, and probably OPV and Dyson-C-Ti solar cells have represented the main research avenue in this field. This technology takes its name from the primary photoexcitation in this system, correlated electron hole bonded exciton photoexcitation, which need, as Natalie was showing before, an extra energy to be separated and actually generating charges. So the result of this is that actually, if we look at the VOC of your device as a function of the band gap of the active materials, there is an intrinsic loss in which is actually determined by the excess energy that you need to provide some in part of that excess energy that you need to provide to split the primary photoexcitation. About let's say nearly 2 years ago, in the group of Michael Gretzel in EPFL, they embodied these hybrid perovskite crystals as a light antenna in their Dyson-C-Ti device. So the main structure was the typical structure of a Dyson-C-Ti solar cell, where mesoporous TiO2 film was covered by a monolayer of these pigments, then infiltrated by an all-transporting material. And the result was already quite exciting, providing a nearly 10% power conversion efficiency. At the time, was a kind of a record in this technology. But what was more interesting is that about 2 months later, the publication of this report in the group of Oxford, led by Henry Snaith, he actually demonstrated that these perovskite crystals cannot work in on cannot doesn't they don't work only as an absorber, but they can only sustain electron transport, and he proved it depositing these perovskite crystals not on an injecting substrate like the TiO2, but on simple alumina mesostructure substrate. And the main point of this result is that actually changing the scaffold of the device architecture, he was able to gain a lot in terms of VOC. This is placing this type of device in quite a competitive position if you compare it with the best probably performing at the moment gallium arsenide solar cells. So this is already was let's say generating a lot of excitement in the field. So the main question was actually what is really going on in this device, what we are talking about. So this is the active material I'm talking. This is a hybrid crystal. The name perovskite actually is a crystalline structure. So it's a kind of actually it includes a very large family of crystals. And the specific in this specific case, what I'm talking about is an organometal allied system where an organic cation is holding an inorganic structure which form a sort of cage, and this crystal is a self-assembled from solution. Though the organic cation is not really acting a role in terms of the directly playing a role in terms of the electronic properties of the materials, as your orbitals don't participate to the frontier orbital of the semiconductor. Actually, yeah, it has an important role in the let's say in the structural property of the system. And as we will see, at the end of the story, they definitely influence how the crystal actually behave. Outside in the cage, inorganic cage is made of a metal atom, which in this case is the lead, coordinated by halogen atoms. And these are directly influencing the electronic property of the crystal. In particular, the conduction band is led by the lead, while the valence band is the result of an hybridization of the p and s orbital of the lead and halogen materials. This means that this system can be easily, let's say, designed, and the optical electronic property can be somehow tuned by, let's say, we can say trivial chemistry, where these elements can be substituted. Now, which is the strength of this system? Yes. So, as we were saying before, they seem to act very efficiently, nearly like inorganic crystalline semiconductor. But at the same time, we are able to tune their property quite easily. Here you see substitution of the halogen atom going from a larger to smaller element. You are able to shift to in the blue the band gap of the semiconductor, and it can be processed from solution. So it seems to actually represent a software revolution in terms of what we were looking for in the photovoltaic field. So we were looking for something that was behaving like inorganic crystalline semiconductor, but with the property tunability of organic molecules, so colloidal system. And this has led, of course, to I mean, an amazingly rapid improvement in the device performances in the last 2 years. Actually, here the most efficient device I'm citing here is about 16%. But I'm coming from the HOPV conference, where nearly, I mean, 19.3% has been announced. So, as you can see, the field is quite excited at the moment. But the point is, if you ask me how do they work, how far they can go, I would be quite, let's say, embarrassed, because we don't really know. There is, strictly speaking, there is not a defined technology where we can put now at the moment this system. We have assisted to a very, let's say, interesting evolution in terms of device architecture in the last 1.5 years, which led to different, let's say, performances of the device. So the situation at the moment is really to understand which are the working mechanism of this system, and which is the final probable architecture that can provide the best performances. Here, for example, after, let's say, a few months after the first report, in Oxford, has been demonstrated that using this alumina scaffold, reducing the size of the alumina scaffold, thus moving from a mesostructure system to nearly a thin film configuration, where the alumina scaffold is extremely thin with respect to the capping layer of the perovskite on top, it is possible to achieve nearly 12% of power conversion efficiency of the device. What was interesting is that this was possible from solution process by through solution processable methodologies only when the hybrid perovskite crystal used has this particular chemical composition. So where the PbI3 original crystal structure used by EPFL is doped by a chlorine atom. Then, just after a few months later, it was shown that actually it was possible to be even beyond the 12%, reaching about 15% efficiency with the chlorine system through through evaporation, vapor deposition of the precursor of these crystals, while at the same time a sequential deposition, so an improvement of the crystallization process of the crystals, was able also for the PBI3 in a mesoporous configuration to deliver impressive performances. So the question now actually is, I mean, why this is a? What is allowed in some particular crystal to work in a thin-film structure, and how the crystal deposition is playing a role in the working mechanism of the device itself. So here we start asking ourselves the first question: is that actually which is the diffusion length of the photoexcited species in these materials? And what you can see here is the absorption spectrum of the chlorine dope perovskite crystals. And here what you see is the photoluminescence spectrum. So this material, this semiconductor, has actually a direct band gap. We can see light emitted from the crystals. So since as Carlo was saying, I'm coming from the in the past year I was mainly working with conjugated polymer disensitized system, and in the borrowing some experience from taking something from my previous experience, we thought, okay, we can probably use photoluminescence quenching to work out the electron hole diffusion length in this material. Materials. As in the past, this technique were very much used for, identify the diffusion length of the exciton, for example, in conjugated polymer. So what you do here, you measure the photoluminescence lifetime of your pristine materials, and then you see its quenching when selective quencher are deposited on top of the pristine film, and you model it through a diffusion model. Now, this seems to be quite straightforward, but there is a strong hypothesis that we need to confirm, and it is actually that the photo the emissive species are actually probing the entire photocarious population that we have in our system. So to do so, we use a pump probe spectroscopy that Natalie was already very well explaining previously. So what you do, you monitor the photoexcited population of your the entire photoexcited population in your system. So in this case, what you can see here is a transient absorption spectrum of the pristine perovskite film, gated around 200 nanoseconds. And what is interesting for us is this photo bleaching feature. So the photo bleaching feature in this type of system is the result of a transparency induced by a state of filling effect. This means that the photo bleaching is directly proportional to the density of electron and holes in your film. This means that the probing the dynamic of the photo bleaching is actually telling you if there are actually carriers going around in your pristine material. Then, to actually approve, let's say, our photoluminescence quenching methodology to measure electron hole diffusion length, what we need to do is actually monitoring the dynamic of the photo bleaching, the dynamic of the PL, and we realize that they match very well. So this means that whatever you are generating in your semiconductors, at the end it will emit light. So following the diffusion of the quenching of photoluminescence, we are actually able to follow the quenching of the photocarriers. We approve this type of experiment, and we carry on trying to understand what was the difference between the chlorine dope system and the triiodide system. So immediately you can realize that when you measure the photoluminescence of these two pristine materials, the chlorine dope has an extremely long lifetime respect to the triiodide system. Then we select two selective quenchers for electrons, so the PCBM and for holes, which is a molecular Hall conductor, the spiral, O-metad. And we measured the PL quenching in presence of these two quenchers. And what was interesting is that while for the PBI3 system, we were able to extract a diffusion length for balance for electron and hole of about 100 nanometers, which is kind of comparable to the diffusion length of carriers in quantum solution processable quantum dot system. When we dope the PB triiodide with the chlorine atoms, the diffusion length of the photocarriers increase of about one order of magnitude. So this is already telling us why when we make a thin-film structure from triiodide, we are not able to get a higher power conversion efficiency of 4.2% in an optimized structure of 140 nanometers. While doping the crystals with chlorine atoms, we are able actually to achieve the 12% in a thin film configuration. So we were able in this way to kind of shine some light on the reason why some device architecture can work better from one material and some another device architecture for another one. So the PBI3 works very well in a mesostructure configuration, while the chlorine dope can actually work also in a thin film structure. Of course, I mean, so far I've been talking about photo-excited species, photocarrier. The question actually, the next question we want to answer is actually which is the nature of this photocarrier? I mean, what are we transporting, energy or of carrier, which means what we really need in our device architecture is an heterojunction to separate the correlated electron holes or simply a buffer layer for selectively extracting holes and electrons. I mean, here, what I'm showing is, I don't know, it's not appearing. Anyway, the red curve here is the absorption spectrum of the perovskite, the chlorine dope perovskite at room temperature. And when you start cooling down your sample, you see that a sharp transition at the onset of the UV absorption is coming out, and we assign it to an excitonic transition. If you keep cooling down below 160K, what you see is that a second peak is coming out. I mean, this is simply due to a phase transition that the crystals undergo below at a certain temperature. It actually moves from a tetragonal structure to an orthorhombic structure. And this change in the phase induces, of course, a change in the band gap of the materials that is inducing this peak here. Of course, I mean, the co-presence of these two, let's say, peak together is due to a lack of uniformity in the system, in the thin film, which at some point is giving you the two phases together. Of course, if you keep cooling down, you will see that one phase, the orthorhombic phase will be dominant, and the excitonic transition will get sharper and sharper. Now, for people working in organic solar cells or in disensitized solar cells, we were used to excitons more close to Frankel-like. I mean, Frankel is the ideal situation, but let's say we are more in this direction. Now, in perovskite, we should think in a different way and move to the other side, let's say, of the excitonic family, towards the Wonjemot exciton. What is a Wonjemot exciton? Is generally present in solid with a tightly bound atom, and is due, of course, to a lack of screening that in the perovskite system is due to the co-presence of organic and inorganic moieties together. is an adrogenoid system, and it can be described differently from the Frankel exciton from by a center of mass and an exciton radius that generally is larger than the lattice constant. This means that it is pretty much delocalized on the entire crystals. And you define a bending energy as let's say the difference in energy between your localized transition and the conduction band. People generally as used, oh, okay, I missed my table, so I will tell you by here. So people generally, in the field of inorganic crystalline semiconductor, to estimate the bending energy of the exciton, they generally use a photoluminescence photoluminescence dependence of on temperature. But of course, in that case, we are in an ideal situation most of the time where the crystal is perfect. In solution processable system, this becomes a bit more difficult. So what we decide to do, so probably I move to the other one that is becomes more clear, is to exploit the let's say the relationship between the broadening of the excitonic transition and the exciton bending energy, making two assumptions. So one is that the inhomogeneous broadening is not temperature mainly not temperature dependent, and that in the temperature range we are interested in, which is the one above 160K, which is the crystal let's say where the crystal structure is stable at room temperature. The main interaction between phonon and exciton leads to exciton ionization. Which means, let's say, dissociation of our exciton. This means that we can describe the, let's say, we can associate the broadening of the excitonic transition with the binding energy, considering that the lifetime, the excitonic population is mainly affecting by thermal ionization. And in this way, we were able to extract an exciton binding energy of the order of about 50 millielectron volt, which is twice KT at room temperature. So we have an excitonic transition, but the question is, it actually populated at room temperature and in the photovoltaic condition, which is an important thing to consider. In fact, if you take the psi equation, which gives you a kind of a ratio between free charges and exciton in at the a thermodynamic equilibrium, and you take into account the mass law, where the total photoexcitation density is given by the sum of the population of free charges and exciton, if you plot these as a function of the total photoexcitation, realize that a very low photoexcitation with a binding energy of 50 millielectron volt and room temperature, free charges represent the main population. However, what is very important to consider if you are if you do optical spectroscopy experiment, or if you aim to other applications that are not simply are not only photovoltaics, but lasing, as recently has been proved that this material can also very well lase, you realize that when you increase the total photoexcitation, the main population is switching from free charges to exciton. Okay, so we were pretty much happy about that because we were kind of putting some flags, let's say, understanding what is going on. But all I was I've been describing to you now is actually true for both the PBI3 and the chlorine dope system, as long as we were working with a flat perovskite film, where for flat I mean that I crystallize them in situ on a flat substrate. The story is completely different than when you move to a mesostructured substrate. So if you crystallize, again, in situ, your perovskite in a mesoporous scaffold, in this case was alumina, but also for the TiO2. So as you see, even if you cool down to 4K your sample, we did not absorb the excitonic transition. Okay, you can also say, well, I mean, we already said that at room temperature, free carriers are the main population, so who cares? But what is telling you is that the properties and the photophysical picture you want to give to this material are strongly influenced by the condition you are growing them. So you need to be very, very careful when you are trying, let's say, to give an answer on how actually this material are behaving. Trying to understand why this is going on, we try to get some information what happened when you move from a flat film to a film grown in a mesoporous scaffold with a porous of about the diameter of about 20-30 nanometers. So the first thing, okay, also this is disappeared, but what we did is measuring, the XRD of these of films were changing the thickness of the scaffold. This means getting a thicker and thicker film of perovskite on top. And what we were, I was drawing here, is actually the size of the crystals when you don't have any capping layer, any scaffold here, and a scaffold of about 1 micron here. And the size, the medium size of the crystals that move from 500 nanometers here to about less than 50 nanometers when you have the scaffold. So what he's telling us is that when we have larger crystals in the flat film, we are able to observe the excitonic peak. When you have small crystal grown in the scaffold, we don't see any, and we see a blue shift of the UV absorption. And in the case of the optimized, or let's say the device architecture, which is the state of the art for the moment, you actually have a combination of the two. This means that you have a kind of a mixture of compounds in the same in what you think is the active is the active materials. And of course, this has also some some influence on the device performances. So if you look here at the photocurrent and the VOC, you see that you can modulate both, changing the device architecture. And even more, as a proof of this homogeneity, what we found is that changing again the thickness of the scaffold, modulating the size of the crystals, also the PL lifetime changes. This can, at the first glance, can look like a sort of a quenching of the PL, due probably to grain boundary defect when the crystal gets smaller. But actually, if you look more in detail, the energetic of this emission, when we excite from the scaffold side, which means where the crystals are smaller, you can see a red shift of your emission spectrum. Well, when you excite prevalently the flat, you see that there is no evolution of your photoluminescence. This means that energetically the system is pretty much is very dishomogeneous. And the change in the shift in the PL peak, the change in the lifetime, can of course telling you that also the photocarriers can have a different diffusion length when you modulate the crystallization. We decide to go a bit further in detail. I try to understand what is going on more at a molecular level, because I was saying this material is extremely exciting because the relationship between structure and property is strong. I would say that probably they are a sort of the strongest emphatization of functional materials, where whatever you are, every stimulus you give to the system, they will respond in a very mostly of the time unexpected way. So what we try to understand is, let's move more in at a molecular level and see how these organic and inorganic moieties are really interacting between them. And to do so, we use a Raman spectroscopy as a probe. One of our collaborator, Filippo De Angelis, in the he simulate for us the Raman spectrum of different crystal structure. So the tetragonal one, which is the one stable at room temperature, but in different, let's say, configuration, which means in a different orientation of the organic cation respect to the inorganic cage, and in the orthorhombic structure, which is more stable at low temperature, and in principle is more order. So let's say we try to look at a different degree of disorder, order disorder. Now, what I mean for disorder and order? Here you see a section of the crystal with an inorganic cage around and the organic molecule inside. So what I mean for disorder is when the organic cations is randomly placed inside the inorganic cage. Because the cation is a methylamine molecule, ions, the nitrogen and the halogen, the hydrogen and the halogen atom in the inorganic cage will strongly interact and influence each other. This means that if the organic cation is a randomly placed inside, also the interaction with the inorganic cage will be quite random somehow. While in the other case, the organic cations are placed tail to tail respect to each other. This means that the crystal will feel a better, let's say, in a more homogeneous, let's say, stimuli in a larger terms of delocalization. So what we found very interesting is that in the Raman spectrum we found two signatures of this type of orientation. Around 200 in this dye frequency, this peak here, you can see that lose intensity when we move from the disorder of order. Now, this transition in the Raman spectrum is telling us is a signature of the rotational mode of the organic cation and how this is influenced by the halogen atom. Okay. On the other, similar, let's say, similar mode is around 150 here. And it behaves in other way, in the opposite way, which means that this transition gains strength when we move from a randomly oriented cation, which is free to rotate as it wants, to a more ordered and stacked, let's say, configuration. Now, if we use this map, let's say, to probe our system, what we immediately see is that if you compare a triiodide system in the mesoin flat configuration, what you see is that this peak here loses in intensity and the other one become more defined. So this is already telling us that if we leave the crystal free to crystallize in a larger dimension, the organic cation will let's say, find a more... A better configuration. So it's probably a minimum of energy in its configuration. But what is very important is that this type of interaction is influencing also the PBI stretching mode, which is telling us how the organic molecule is influencing the property of the inorganic cage, which will then, of course, influence the electronic and optical property of your crystals. In fact, if you see here, I took from an old paper from the 90s the Raman spectrum of a perfect PBI2 crystals, which is a layered 2D kind of system, and here the same crystal gets distorted by introducing some organic molecule inside. And what you see is that this distortion is induced in our system when the organic cations is randomly placed. But when the cations get this tail-to-tail configuration, the PBI perfect, let's say, stretching mode are restored somehow. Okay, this was already one indication telling us how the interaction at molecular level can then influence the system at the mesoscopic level. But Since I mean the other open question was the role of chlorine in these in these crystals, we decided to use the same. Oh, sorry, I forgot this. That actually, in this case, we were probing again the same material, so again the PBI3, but with two different crystallization method. One from spin coating. Okay, that was the method that was not allowing us to get a thin film configuration. And the second one, we crystallize it through the two-step deposition, which is the one I was mentioning at the beginning, able to deliver the 15% efficiency cell. And as you can see here, we again see the same thing, telling you how the same material can behave in a very different way, simply depending on how you leave them crystallizing. And I think we learned all this also from the previous talk today. Then the next step was understanding which is the effect of chlorine in these crystals. And we prepare, let's say, the two materials, both in the mesostructure configuration. And what we realize is that the presence of chlorine is somehow, let's say, inducing the same effect that you have when you leave the crystal growing on the flat substrate. So, let's say, the first answer is that the chlorine is definitely doing something in terms of crystallization. Then the other thing we notice is doing some XRD on this sample. Is that actually, as also in the Raman, actually, we were not able to probe any actual signature of the presence of chlorine in the crystal unit. But on the other side, what we notice is that the presence of chlorine generally induces a larger size of the crystals. And even more interestingly, what we saw looking at compositional analysis through EDX experiment is that in the mesoporous system, we don't see any chlorine in the crystal unit, but we do see presence of chlorine in the sample. So what we actually we deduce from this is that somehow the chlorine in actually in let's say, sustaining also some theoretical studies that recently were published, the chlorine is not really stable in the crystal structure, but is slowing down probably the crystallization process, allow the crystal to grow in a better, let's say, more order or better quality, which then will induce, let's say, the optical property that we can actually observe. And let's say another interesting observation that we were able to do is that while in the mesoporous scaffold we were able to probe the presence of chlorine, on the flat substrate there was no chlorine at all, or below the, let's say, the sensitivity of our experiments. This means probably that the leftover of these chlorine ions probably get absorbed by the oxide scaffold, the oxide substrate, which may probably change the wetting layer and thus also helping the crystallization and uniformity of your film. That's why also the thin film is able to be, let's say, uniformly deposited in presence of this doping. So, to conclude, what we have seen is that in the, we were able to achieve a 1 micron diffusion length of our photocarriers in presence of the mixed allied perovskite, that there is an upper limit, the upper estimator of the exciton binding energy of about 50 milli-electron volt. And this means that the perovskite solar cells are not excitonic in their operating principle. But however, exciton can play a role in the photophysics of these materials if you are thinking of a different application. And finally, we can probably say that the chlorine plays a role in the crystallization mechanism, doesn't really change the optical electronic property intrinsically, let's say, of the crystal, but can change the morphology and the structure of the crystal, thus helping, let's say, getting a better device architecture. And here I can conclude with the acknowledgement of people have been working with me from IIT in this project, the group of Oxford and Filippo De Angelis from CNR in Milan, in Perugia, and fundings. And I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Emily, for being exciting talk and also giving us back a little bit of time before lunch. There's plenty of time for questions. Gary.
The origin of no. Actually, what is important is that if you look at the flat films, no, the doping is really, really is much lower. It's at the order of 10 to 16. While if we move to the mesopore, the one grown in the mesoporous scaffold of alumina, then the doping increase. So I don't know if that is actually, so the material itself is intrinsic probably, and is the growing, the way they are made that probably can induce this this type of, this doping. But I don't know, I don't know more details. And also, as I was saying before, we saw some, doing pump probe spectroscopy, we definitely saw the bleaching of trap state, sub-band gap state. But then I realized that it is very much related to the way they are made. I mean, the interlay, the layer on top used to protect. So it's really not clear to me. Yes. Okay, this is a kind of, we need to think that these type of devices are stemming from the desensitized community, okay? So people were used at the time, they were working like a dye, so initially we need the mesoporous scaffold. So that's why was the firstly they were used. But then we realized that actually the presence of the mesoporous scaffold was helping the crystallization or the uniformity of the crystallization somehow. Okay, so this why if you make solution process, from spin coating, okay, you do need the scaffold, also very thin, but it helps you to get a uniform film on top. Of course, if you evaporate them, you make through a two-step deposition, realize that probably you don't really need. But still, it's a learning, it's a steep, but a learning curve at the moment.
There's one question here and then one question. Okay. All right.
So you mentioned that the chloride content was 20%.
In weight, 0.3% in weight, but this is what we detected in the mesoporous configuration. Sorry? No, at least I am aware. Optically, you mean? I didn't really understand. So, semantical study on the role of chlorine. There is one which is a Journal of Chemistry Materials of last year. Colella is the first name, and they were trying to increase the molarity of chlorine doping. But what you get is PbCl3 crystals. Telling again that probably is not fully stable the chlorine in this type of crystal structure. Yeah. So initially what we thought that probably one really small amount of chlorine is going in, inducing probably a distortion, which also induced this very long lifetime. But it can, as I was showing before, because of changing the crystal size, which or changing the, let's say, the interplay between the organic and inorganic, you can induce a polarization inside, probably simply changing the presence of chlorine in the crystallization process, change probably only the nature of the crystal, the structure.
Mm-hmm. As opposed to
yeah.
I can envision that your perovskite has access to crystallize on more crystal faces of your either your aluminum oxide or
yeah.
your titanium oxide. And what I'm wondering is how do the different lattice parameters
I don't know. I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I can reply. I can answer to this question. But actually, what I was more thinking is more than crystallization seed in terms of substrate. There is also a strong role of the porosity, because of course, because you spin from you spin coat them from a common solvent, a common solution. So this means that changing the wettability and the porosity of the film, the porosity and wettability, what happens is that you start evaporating your solvent while the precursor start precipitating. So the wettability may change this concentration of your precursor in the, and this may change the crystallization. We believe that in the CW, let's say quasi CW condition in a solar cell, we have free carriers. Okay. I mean, starting from the binding energy of the exciton, so we can already guess that. But what is interesting is that this photoluminescence experiment were very well in agreement with the terahertz data. So terahertz were probing a similar, similar diffusion length and similar lifetime of the species the terahertz was detecting. Since the terahertz was mainly detecting free carriers, so it seems that we are in, I mean, the assignment is pretty acceptable.
There was one more around here somewhere, I believe.
Hi, thanks for the very nice talk. I just have a question that you probably got a lot. When you said that you see this glitching signal which resembles the
No, the stimulated emission we do see in the pump probe, but is slightly shifted. So in the nanosecond, I'm pretty sure that that is. And then at the end, I mean, yeah, I see your point. But in the nanosecond, it was very much. I mean, in the femtosecond, we do see a slight, because there is quite very well resolved. So you can really distinguish the other peak. That we don't see much in the nanosecond, probably because the density is lower. Okay, this is for us the main question at the moment, but probably the. I mean, you have the excitonic state. Probably, Carlos, you can help with that. Because we have the excitonic state there. And what we were also discussing with the group in Cambridge was, okay, we have free charges that are dominating the scene. So let's say the lifetime of the photoluminescence is determined by the free carriers, that they stay around. I mean, there is another question, that if they are really free, if there is any correlation, maybe one is stacked, but this is another point. Now, when they recombine, they need to pass through the exciton state or not? It's a dynamic condition, no? Where you form the exciton and it gets splitted. So I don't really know if you pass through the exciton. But what is sure is that the free carriers are, let's say, determining the lifetime. And so they are there around, and then at some point they recombine, and probably they meet.
I think just to be able to enjoy. glass of beer, remember? Let's thank her. Again,
thank you.
Michelle said it was inside. So.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so Michelle said it's very nice.
Do you like?
Yeah, I was going to show you.
I'm always a very nice.